All right, folks, welcome back to AlphaGo versus the world. This is game 15, and Michael, we're moving into a new phase of this series. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Okay, from here on, we're going to see a few world champions challenging AlphaGo, and so it's going to be very exciting. Actually, the games are quite amazing throughout. But even the openings that I'm going to be focusing on in this series are going to be pretty amazing. We're going to see AlphaGo sort of breaking the rules a number of times and getting away with it. Or actually, it's an improvement on what we thought was proper.
Excellent. All right, folks. Well, this is going to be a challenge for us. You know, we're keeping these fairly short, but there's lots of fun stuff to look at. And again, we'll be getting into greater detail in Volume 2 of AlphaGo to Zero. All right, Michael, let's take a look at the game.
Okay, this is Park Junghwan. He's a Korean nine dan player, and he's in his and at the time of this game, he was in his early 20s, and he's a four-time world champion. And he was in the process of taking them, so I think maybe at the time he only had about two world championships. But he's a very formidable fighting player. I remember I was once a referee at a game he played. And he's very humble. Like he's very careful about what he says and very dedicated to Go. Like studying the game after the game, the after game analysis was very thorough on everything. So Park has the black stones and he plays the small Shimari. And so this is a point where he's still playing the style that humans were used to. Already in this series, we're getting to the 15th game. This is the 15th game. And we're seeing some of the human players imitating AlphaGo, you might say, and playing the large Shimari, which was not so popular before AlphaGo played it, and just to see what AlphaGo will do with that. And you might remember that AlphaGo was answering with this Shimari. So that's a pattern you'll see. And so the human player is trying to figure out exactly how this was working, because this is the favorite opening for black for AlphaGo. So there were a lot of players who were trying that, but we're seeing Park playing his own style here. And this is perfectly fine for black. And white plays this. And this shoulder hit was really kind of one of the signature marks of this master version of AlphaGo, because it just loved to play the shoulder hits. And then it would jump here. And this was slightly different from the shoulder hits that Go Sagan used to like to tell us to play. And because Go Sagan would usually be extending. So I had a lot of fun comparing that. It turned out in later versions, AlphaGo didn't play this jump very much. But it's a reasonably good move anyway. I think actually I like the master version best because it's easier to understand and easier to incorporate into my own games. And here with AIs, we see that the suggested move is the shoulder hit. Park played this Wariuchi, splitting the side. Actually, black's winning percentage doesn't change very much, whichever choice black makes. It's not such a big mistake. So here, white has played this move, sort of threatening the corner. And this is where the score changes a little bit. Black plays here. And white answers here. And this was actually very efficient for white, because by getting a base here, white has reduced the value of this cut. So the cut is not a real threat here. So what black should have done was black should have been playing from this side, in which case there would have been more potential to be attacking the whole white group on a larger scale. White will probably answer with covering on this side, but you see that white does have some issues here with a black play here or a black play here. White has to deal with that now. And in the process, black is going to get a nice position on the upper side. So this whole process is sort of hard to see at the point where I'm suggesting black should play this move. But in a very natural sequence, it turns out that black gets this nice position on the upper side. And this is perfectly fine for black. So while this move seems perfectly okay, it would have been much more effective if white had been forced to answer directly something like this or something like this, which would be a point move that doesn't have any territory attached to it. But the fact that white could answer this way, getting a base on the upper side and putting some pressure on this black stone, was just slightly efficient for white. And already the AIs are giving white a very small advantage, like it's something like 52% for white or something like that. So it's something that I would not, definitely not recognize. So black plays here. And this is the second point where actually I could see that black was going wrong, but you have to see white's next move to really understand that. Black played here. This was a point where black had to play more forcefully with this move, which would be forcing now. This would be the forcing way to play. And then black gets to capture the one stone. And so taking sente to be able to capture that one stone, and if white plays this way, black can again get a nice position on the left side. This would keep the game fairly close. Whereas in the game, black played here, which was not as forceful. And because of that, white had a way to make use of this stone. But you might note that the ladder doesn't work for white.
Right.
So it's really difficult to see how white is actually going to do that. And the next move is really amazing, where white plays. Maybe I should just show you. I was thinking of giving this a problem for you, but this is
it's a timed game.
Yeah. I'll just show you the move here. White plays here.
That's what I was going to play, actually.
Oh, of course, yeah. and when white plays here, there's no way for black to surround the left side, this area, and capture that white stone at the same time. Like, if, for instance, if black just plays here, black can capture the one stone. But white's going to be able to pop in here, for instance, right, like this. So black plays here, but now this becomes a perfect move. There's no way, again, for black to connect up there on the side and at the same time save that one stone, because if black saves the one stone, white will push through and this looks so bad.
Oof.
So yeah. Black pushed here, and this is where black is starting to fall behind, because black was sort of at a loss at the best move to play. It would have been slightly better for black to push through this way, because now if white plays here, black can play here to connect underneath. In this case, black would be able to connect underneath. Actually, white's probably just going to sort of capture that one black stone. And this would be better because even black sort of gained a move at three on the right side.
Mm.
And this is closer to even. This way, black will not have so much trouble settling this group because black has taken the initiative in the lower right area. So this would still be a playable game. In the actual game, when white played here, black pushed this side. And the problem with this move is that it was not a direct threat. There's no follow-up in which black can easily save this stone and have a successful shape there. So white was able to play away and start the attack on black on the lower side, this group. And by starting that attack, white's going to get the initiative to move first towards the right side. And so the white is starting a flow of play here in the local lower right area that's going to push white towards the right side of the board, which is the last big point. It's the last big opening point. And so white's taking control of that area because white doesn't have to deal with what's happening here on the left side. And that's because when black follows up here, the natural move, and again, you see, it's quite often that AlphaGo allows the opponent to play these moves that look like they're really good shape. But when AlphaGo is playing the other side, it turns out they're not all that important. Like this way, white has been able to keep this position as an advantage to white. And the profit that black is getting is sort of this area, which was no man's land anyway. It wasn't really an important area. So black continues. Black has to do something with this group. Mm-hmm. And this is what I was talking about when I say that when white initiates this fight, actually black had to go back. When white initiates this fight, if we assume something like here, for instance, it does create a kind of a natural sequence where white is going to be moving towards the right side. White's going to get this final point there on the right side of the board, mm-hmm. which is the final big point. It's a very important point. In the game, black started by connecting underneath here. But again, you see that the fact black has used a lot of moves after pushing here and then black had to come back and play here. Black needed two moves there, and still white has gotten something out of this. White has captured the one black stone and pushed black down to the second line. So it wasn't so satisfactory for black to have to spend two moves to get this low position. What black's territory there on the left has been squashed a little bit. Mm-hmm. And white does get to the left side. I think at this point, it's actually difficult for black to win before Komi, even without the Komi. And so this was a game where it was mostly, it was just these two moves on the left, basically. Let's see if I can, I'll just go back to, it was just this move and following, and the following move here, these two moves, I'll mark the two moves I'm talking about that were just a little bit slack, and they allowed white to just sort of leap ahead, leap forward and take control. And already in this position, the right side, whoever plays on the right side, this is going to be big. So the right side is the final big point, which both players should be focusing on. And black never got to play there. Not only did the left side sort of be squashed, but the right side was taken by white. And that's how white took the lead there.
Before we wrap up, quick question, because, you know, as you pointed out at the beginning, this is, you know, this is not some, you know, really young rising pro. This is a preseason, you know, top level title holder and
world champion.
Yeah. And, you know, you're showing two moves. I guess what I'm wondering is, you know, the thing that I think we now know about AIs, which is they're just not attached to hardly anything. They're not attached to their moves. They're not attached to their groups. Mm-hmm. And I guess what I'm wondering here is if, and if this is a good example of even with a top level player, where there was a sort of assumption that, you know, that the opponent would respond, because I just don't really see Park playing those moves. If he, you know, I guess what I'm saying is it seems like black let white get sente when that didn't have to happen.
Well, I think the knight's move that I've left mark here.
Yeah.
The knight's move was actually, I would call that a lapse. I think it was actually a lapse. But after that, this move, black was already in a position where it was very difficult to find a good move. And I'd be surprised by that. I wouldn't even want to call it a mistake, actually. It's a very natural
move.
It's just that I find that the score goes down quite dramatically after that. It's a move that seems so natural.
I
could reason out why it was bad, but it's not something I would be seeing in the game as I was playing, that is.
Interesting. Wow. It's just fascinating that you know, even at this fairly early stage, it's already kind of slipped away. So
basically, just this one slack move there. The nice move. Yeah.
No margin at all. Impressive. Beautiful game. Great commentary. Thank you. Thank you so much for watching. And we'll be back with game 16.